Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us here today. My name is Jennifer Curtis. I'm the Dean of the College of Engineering, and it is my great honor to introduce our college distinguished lecturer, Professor Reginald DesRoches, who is a world-renowned seismic scholar and the Karen and John Huff School Chair and Professor of Civil and Environmental Engineering at the Georgia Institute of Technology. Professor DesRoches was born in Port-au-Prince, Haiti, and today he will be speaking about the earthquake in 2010 that devastated his home country. Officials estimate the Haiti earthquake killed and injured more than 600,000 people and was one of the most destructive natural disasters in modern times. Professor DesRoches served as the key technical leader in the U.S. response to the Haiti earthquake and led a team of engineers and scientists, city planners, to analyze its aftermath. In the United States, nearly half of Americans live in earthquake-prone regions. Professor DesRoches will discuss how his research and all of his experience with the Haiti earthquake can be applied to seismic threats throughout the California region and abroad. Professor DesRoches has focused his research on the design of resilient infrastructure under extreme loads, and he has published more than 300 articles on resilience and seismic risk assessment. He's also participated in numerous congressional briefings to underscore the critical role that university plays in addressing the country's infrastructure crisis and resilience to natural hazards. Professor DesRoches is a fellow of the American Society of Civil Engineers and the Society Structural Engineering Institute. He received the Presidential Early Career Award for Scientists and Engineers. This is an NSF award. It's the highest honor bestowed upon scientists and engineers in the early stages of their career by the National Science Foundation. Most recently, he was a recipient of the 2007 American Society of Civil Engineers Walter Huber Civil Engineering Research Prize and the 2015 American Society of Civil Engineers Charles Martin Duke Lifeline Earthquake Engineering Award. In 2010, he received the Georgia Tech Outstanding Doctoral Thesis Advisor Award, and he served as a thesis advisor to 29 doctoral and 17 master's thesis students thus far in his career. He has earned his PhD in structural engineering at UC Berkeley, so bringing him back to California here, and was recently elected to the Civil Engineering Department's Academy of Distinguished Alumni. We are extremely honored and pleased that he will be speaking here today, and he will be talking on From Haiti to California, Challenges and Opportunities for Reducing Earthquake Risk. Please join me in welcoming him.
Thank you very much, Dean Curtis, and thank you to the faculty at UC Davis, my colleagues in the School of Civil and Environmental Engineering, or the Department of Civil and Environmental Engineering. This is my first visit to UC Davis, although I spent 13 years just up the road at Berkeley. I never had the opportunity to come to Davis, so it's an honor to be here today and spend the day with you and visit with the faculty to see the beautiful campus, all the bikers around here, which is really impressive, and the great facilities and truly the outstanding faculty that you have, particularly some of the newer faculty that you brought on here. It was already a great department, and now it's going to even be greater with some of the true talent that you have here now. So it's an honor to be here and an honor to talk to you a little bit about my work in earthquake engineering over the past 20-something years. I began as a student at Berkeley in mechanical engineering in 1985, my undergraduate. And just before I was finishing my undergraduate degree in mechanical engineering, we had an earthquake in 1989. I was a student on campus. I can see the earthquake impact from where I was on campus, on the upper part of campus on the north side. And since then, I knew I wanted to be a structural earthquake engineer. I finished my mechanical degree because I was only a few classes from finishing, but then I changed over for my master's and PhD to structural engineering and been studying earthquakes ever since. So I'll talk to you a little bit about my experiences. This is one of those talks where I touch on a number of things. I'll talk about the work in Haiti, but I'll also talk about some of the research I've been doing here in the U.S., focused on some of the issues and challenges that we have in earthquakes in the United States. And I'll do it all in 40 minutes, I promise. So this slide just shows just a little bit about sort of the grand challenge that we face in earthquake engineering, particularly as it relates to developing countries that have some unique challenges, not only in terms of the infrastructure and the vulnerability of the built infrastructure they have, but really the social vulnerability in many of these countries in terms of the lack of resources, in some cases lack of education, and what role that plays when a disaster unfolds. And we certainly saw that in the case of Haiti. This is a picture from the Haiti earthquake. And one of the reasons I'll talk about the Haiti earthquake is because not only because it was so devastating, but it shows the many dimensions of disaster resilience and disaster response and some of the things that you have to learn outside the technical pieces that you learn in the classroom about being able to respond to natural disasters. In the next 35 years, the urban infrastructure will double. So we will be building a lot of infrastructure around the world, much of this in developing countries around the world. And so the challenge that we face is how do we design, or in some cases redesign, these communities so that they consume fewer resources, produce less waste. And I'm fortunate many people here I know are working in a sustainability area. Many of the faculty I had a chance to talk to today are working on some of these problems. And how do we make these communities more resilient to the impacts of natural hazards? If we look at this plot that shows worldwide natural disasters over the last, 35 years from 1980, and we're looking here, it shows various natural disasters, climatological in terms of droughts and heat waves, but also floods, meteorological storms, and then geophysical storms such as earthquakes. We see that the impact of these disasters, in fact, are increasing. So you would think with all of our technology and our improvements in knowledge, we'd see a decrease in the impact of these natural disasters. But in fact, we're seeing an increase in terms of both the frequency and the increasing impact in terms of, in some cases, loss of life, but also certainly economic. If we look at just earthquakes, which is what I'm going to focus my talk on today because this is what I've been studying for most of my career, this figure is really fascinating to me. It shows earthquakes. Each dot represents, and some of you may have seen this, each dot here represents an earthquake that has occurred since 1900, so roughly over the past 100 years or so. And it's plotted on the x-axis, shows the earthquake magnitude, which we all typically use to indicate the intensity of the earthquake. And then on the y-axis is deaths per earthquake. And you see here it's in log scale, so it goes from 10 to 100 to 1,000 and all the way up to a million at the very top here. And what's interesting about it, and we put a couple of earthquakes that we're familiar with, the Haiti earthquake in 2010 and the Chile earthquake here. And obviously, one interesting thing that jumps out is the Haiti earthquake was much smaller in magnitude, but yet the casualties were orders of magnitude higher than the Chile earthquake. But what's interesting, and I've highlighted this in yellow, in the last 10 years, five of the most deadliest earthquakes have occurred in the last 10 to 15 years or so. Which, if you sit down and think about this, earthquakes have been happening over the past 100 years, but the five deadliest have occurred just in recent time. And so it begs a few questions. Where is the next mega disaster going to occur? Some people believe, people who studied this believe, that we may see an earthquake, one earthquake, kill 1 million people. The Haiti earthquake killed around 300,000, 200,000 to 300,000. One earthquake killed 1 million people. And then what can we do to identify and reduce the risk to some of these countries that are extremely vulnerable to the impacts of natural disasters? So let me talk a little bit about the challenges at a high level that I see in terms of earthquake-resistant design. One is that we have aging and deteriorating infrastructure. So those of you who are members of ASCE or get the ASCE report card, they grade infrastructure every couple of years, and we typically get a grade of a D or a D+, or in some cases a C- if we're really good that year. But our infrastructure is certainly aging and deteriorating, and that's why you see many people currently running for president talking about investing in our infrastructure, because our infrastructure is certainly aging. And this makes us much more vulnerable to the impacts of natural disasters, including earthquakes. Our infrastructure has become increasingly interdependent. So now we're seeing more and more where we have failure of one system, we're getting failure of another. So when you lose power, you tend to lose other systems such as water or gas or telecommunications. So these systems are really, really interconnected, and you're starting to see more and more these cascading effects from one infrastructure system to the next. And megacities and urbanization, this is really where a big part of the problem is. We have more and more of these cities that are becoming very largely populated, and in many cases, they tend to live right on a fault or very close to a fault line. And here we see how the number of cities with a million or more people has increased dramatically over the past few decades. And now we have 37 cities with more than 10 million people. Many of these cities are primarily in parts of the Middle East and Asia, and many of these cities are in areas where we know we have earthquake risk or earthquake hazards. And so clearly that's going to be a challenge moving forward in terms of how we make these communities safer as they get larger and larger populations living very close to a very hazardous area. Earthquake risk reduction is really a multi-hazard, a multi-scale as well as a multi-dimensional problem. Multi-scale in the sense that you really have to understand what's happening on the material, a nano level of materials, and many of you here are studying that. But you also have to understand what's happening on the community, the state, and even the country level in terms of how systems will behave after a disaster unfolds. Multi-dimensional, because there are many dimensions, not just the physical infrastructure, but the natural environment and the social systems and how they're operating play a major role in terms of what happens after an earthquake in particular. And then perceptions of earthquakes, and this is something that's close to home for me, perceptions of earthquakes really vary between the East Coast and West Coast. You're all West Coast people. You know you have earthquakes. When you have a tremor, you know what a tremor is. You probably even wake up and say, that was a magnitude 5.3. I used to be good at that when I lived in Berkeley, sort of predicting what it was after I felt it. On the East Coast, where we know, in other parts of the US, where we know we have earthquakes, the perception of earthquakes are not quite what they should be. And this is just a funny little spoof from South Carolina, Charleston region that had an earthquake a couple of years ago, and you know, we will rebuild. It's a fairly small earthquake, but they were proud that their infrastructure withstood the earthquake. But this is a challenge that we have. We had an earthquake in Atlanta not too long ago, and people thought it was an elephant stampede in some cases, and many things, but nobody thought it was an earthquake. So we do have earthquakes on the East Coast, but the perception of earthquakes is very different from the knowledge that you have on the West Coast. And then what's happening now in parts of the country like Oklahoma and Kansas with these induced earthquakes, in some cases, in this case, from wastewater injection. So I was in a really interesting talk last week on a National Academies committee I'm on, where somebody from USGS came and showed us the new maps that show the earthquake risk without induced earthquakes in Oklahoma and that with the earthquake map and that with induced earthquakes. And so we're seeing a major change in parts of the Midwest where they traditionally haven't had earthquakes, and they're having fairly sizable earthquakes. Oklahoma had one just a few weeks ago that was around a 6 earthquake, and clearly the infrastructure in Oklahoma is not prepared to handle earthquakes of that magnitude. And so the earthquake maps are changing because of this issue of wastewater injection, and we're not exactly sure how we will deal with this in terms of making sure that infrastructure is more robust. So I'm going to talk for a few minutes about the Haiti earthquake. It was really fascinating, is not the right word, but an earthquake that showed so many dimensions of what happens, what can happen in a natural disaster when certain influences and certain things take place, or you have certain social conditions in a country in terms of things going really bad. To understand a Haiti earthquake, you certainly have to understand the context in which the earthquake occurred. I happened to travel to Haiti. I was part of one of the first teams that went there 7 days after the earthquake. They wanted people who spoke Creole or French to be able to do rapid building assessments. And so I went as part of that team to do that fairly early on. And I'll talk a little bit about what we did and what we found. The Haiti country has a very unique history. It was the first freed black nation in the world, 1804, shortly after the U.S. got its independence. Port-au-Prince, the city of Port-au-Prince, is one of the most densely populated cities in the Western Hemisphere with 3 to 4 million people in a fairly, really geographically small area. Haiti has one of the highest exposures to natural disasters, in particular, natural hazards, in particular earthquakes and hurricanes. Both the southern part of the country and the northern part of the country have known fault lines. and they have frequent flooding and frequent hurricanes. And then very highly vulnerable infrastructure. Their buildings are not built up to code. They have very little in terms of transportation networks, and less than 10% of the population has access to clean water or electricity. So it's a very vulnerable country from an infrastructure perspective. And high environmental degradation, and I'll show a picture of that in a second. It's the poorest country in the Western Hemisphere. And you can see here what most people live on. It's about $2 per day, roughly. High literacy rate and a very young and vulnerable population. And when we're talking about environmental degradation, this is a picture of looking at the island of Hispaniola, which Haiti shares with the Dominican Republic. And you can see here sort of the difference between Haiti and the DR, the Dominican Republic, in terms of the number of trees and how that impacts the country in many ways, particularly when they get lots of water and flooding and so forth. But Haiti has been deforesting really since the 1960s for many years. And you can see here what impact it's had on the country's topography. So the Haiti earthquake occurred it was a magnitude 7, very similar to what we had in 1989, Loma Prieta earthquake. It occurred at 4:53 p.m. And that time is very, very important because it occurred right before jobs let out, right before schools let out. And this time had a major impact on the number of casualties that we ended up seeing in the earthquake. If it happened 15 or 20 minutes later, I think the numbers would have been very, very different. Most people were still in their offices, or in case of kids, they were still in school and kindergartens and aftercare. And we see that in terms of the number of casualties that occurred. It was a fairly shallow earthquake, 8.1 miles, and it was fairly close to the downtown area of Port-au-Prince. About 15 miles to the west of Port-au-Prince is where the earthquake occurred. So it was a fairly close earthquake in terms of its proximity to a major population area. And when we look at the results of the earthquake, it was truly devastating. You know, 250,000 to 300,000 people died. They don't have a good record of it because people were being sort of put in mass graves without any sort of records being maintained. It's the largest in terms of per capita, five times more than the second deadliest earthquake, which was in 1972 in Nicaragua. So really deadly in terms of the number of people. If you think about that for a second, you know, 300,000 people dying in a city of, you know, roughly 3 million, to make the math nice. One in 10 people in Port-au-Prince died. If you think about that, it's really staggering. And you can sense it when you go around. When we were there, everybody we talked to had some level of loss of life, whether it was, in many cases, a child or a cousin or a parent. Many, many people felt the impact of this in terms of the large loss of life to family. Many of the government buildings collapsed. As we can see here, the major presidential palace collapsed in the earthquake. Many of the police stations had collapsed. And one of the things that we did while we were asked to do while we were there is to look at go into a Ministry of Justice courthouse, which had partially collapsed. And we had no idea why they were asking us to go into this somewhat dangerous building. We later found out they were looking for the prison records for the prisoners that had escaped from the prison that had collapsed in the earthquake, so they can begin trying to retrieve and find many of those prisoners. 5,000 schools collapsed, and around 40,000 school children died. This is probably the most tragic part of this earthquake. It's really the massive loss of life for young children during the earthquake. And many homes and commercial buildings collapsed. 1 to 1.6 million people were homeless. And in many cases, they were homeless for many years because it took a while to get people back into some sort of shelter following the earthquake. The estimated cost was $14 billion, and as you remember before I said the GDP of the country is $9 billion. This is the first time we've seen an event exceed the GDP of a country, which is really somewhat unusual to see, and obviously it's never happened before. So really a devastating earthquake on all fronts. And this is a kindergarten that we had gone by that I think 40 kindergarten children had died in this earthquake in that building right there. So one of the things that we were asked to do when we went down there, again, it was 7 days afterwards. It was sort of still in a response mode, but they needed people to go in and look at buildings to determine whether or not they were safe or not safe. And there's a procedure from ATC that you do that, where you tag the building either green, yellow, or red based on the structural integrity of the building. And we did a lot of hospitals, some clinics, and we did a fair number of warehouses that had food, and this is one of them. And so this is where you sort of, you know, from an ethical perspective, you really have to put what your the technical aspects in context. And so we went to this building, it was really fairly unsafe. And if we were tagging this building in the US and it didn't have food, I guarantee you we would deem it unsafe. We would have red tagged it. But we went in there and they told us the food was perishable, it would have to be disposed in 3 to 4 days because of the type of food that was in there. And the building was pretty marginal. So we had to sort of make a decision as to whether to tag it red, yellow, or green. And whether to say, and the consequences of doing that, we knew the consequences in terms of all this food at a time where people needed food. And so the long story is we ended up saying this building was yellow. You can go in there, retrieve the food, and come out. But we would have made a very different decision if this building were in a different country at a different time and it wasn't an issue of the other issues that were going on in Haiti at the time. So it was really something that we struggled with from an ethical perspective, because we're trained to do the right thing as engineers, but you always have to sort of put it in the proper context and think about the social implications of what you're doing. Many people talk about all the things that went wrong in the Haiti earthquake, all the buildings that collapsed and all the people that died, but there was certainly one success story, and I think this is truly the success story of the earthquake, was Digicel Tower, which is the tallest building in Haiti. It's the headquarters for their cell phone company. It's a 12-story concrete frame curtain wall. I got to know the designer fairly well. He actually was educated in the U.S., was Haitian-born, educated in the U.S., and went back to practice in Haiti. His daughter was part of our team. She lived in the U.S., but she went back to be part of the response team. This building performed well. And there were, I believe, 600 to 700 people working in the building at the time of the earthquake. I went up to the roof, and I looked around this building. I was standing on the roof and looking around. As far as I can see, everything was flattened. I mean, everything around this building had collapsed. We believe this is an area that has sustained a fairly large amount of shaking compared to some of the other areas in Haiti. So this was truly a success story, and it really hits home the point that as an engineer, you can make a big difference. This one person who designed this building, according to an ACI code, designed it with the right details, saved hundreds of lives. It was really, you know, it was really a powerful story to sit on top of it and see all the devastation around there and all the people that were able to walk out of that building at 4:53, because they don't let you out until 5 o'clock, that lived because one person designed a building correctly. So you can make a difference as an engineer. And that was something that hit home to me, hit home quite a bit as I was participating in the Haiti earthquake. One of the biggest challenges in this earthquake was removal of debris. I think the earthquake produced more debris than just about any natural disaster, maybe minus Katrina is what I had heard. Tons of debris everywhere. And they had, USAID had developed a program where they were paying Haitians to remove debris by hand. I think it was $2 per day to remove debris by hand. And it just wasn't working. It just absolutely wasn't making a dent in all the debris that was there. So I wrote an op-ed. I worked with our communications office and wrote an op-ed to the New York Times that essentially laid out the fact that debris removal is one of the things you absolutely have to do early on. Both psychologically, you can't sort of recover from a disaster if you have a debris psychologically. And the reality is you can't get trucks around. You can't move around. People can't respond to a disaster if there's no debris there, if there's debris everywhere. And 500 words. It was very, very simple. And I've written, you know, a few papers with thousands of words that probably myself and my students read, or the only ones that read them. This 500 words had more impact, I believe, on the recovery of Haiti. Shortly thereafter, I did receive some emails from USAID saying my op-ed wasn't fair, it didn't really do things right, but they changed the way they were doing the debris removal. They had trucks come in, and they were shortly removed after, about 3 months afterwards, the majority of the debris was removed. So it's amazing how powerful 500 words can be. To me, I was just shocked. I wish my journal papers could be 500 words. Unfortunately, they're 10,000 words, but 500 words properly crafted can have a big difference in terms of what happens and how you can change people's minds and how you can highlight something in a very public forum. Related to debris, one of the other things that we did was to see whether or not we can perhaps recycle the debris. One of the challenges they had is they were putting the debris out in the ocean area, in the beach areas, because they really had very little land to put the debris elsewhere. So we wanted to see whether or not it was possible to recycle some of the rubble and make better concrete. So One of the things that we did when we were there, this was my third or fourth trip, we actually collected samples of concrete and infrastructure that was being built at the time, brought the cylinders back to the US and tested them. And those of you who are taking concrete now can see we're getting roughly 1,300 PSI for our strength. That's dramatically lower than what we would expect or accept really in the US for nominal concrete strength. So what we did was we wanted to see whether or not we can use the poor concrete in Haiti that was rubble in making new concrete that had reasonable strength. So we literally brought back bags of rubble, and I got stopped by TSA and had to explain why I have all these rubble in my bags coming from Haiti. But we brought back rubble, we brought it to our lab, and we processed it, and we used the cement that they use in Haiti, but we used proper procedures in terms of water to cement ratio, and we found that we're able to get reasonable concrete, 3,100 PSI, with the bad rubble concrete that we had found in Haiti. So certainly something that we were really excited about, and I think there's some of that going on in Haiti, not to the extent that we would like. Certainly they're using it in roadbeds, but I'm hoping that some of them are using it also in some of the structural systems because it's safer than what they were doing before in terms of the way they were mixing the concrete in Haiti. All right, so I'm going to sort of shift my talk a little bit and talk about what's going on in the U.S. and some of the challenges that we face and some of the opportunities I think that we have. And this is a map of a hazard map in the U.S., 2% in 50-year earthquake, and you can see here where some of the hazardous areas are. Clearly, California is a dangerous area, but also parts of the East Coast, the New Madrid region, and as well as South Carolina and parts of the North, the very far Northeast. So the big one, right? So everybody's talking about Southern California, LA, and the big one, and this is from the LA Times in 2015, 7% chance of a magnitude 8 in the next 30 years, right? So everybody in California sort of knows that they're sitting in a fairly dangerous area when you're looking at Southern Cal. The really big one, right? The New Yorker had a really fascinating article about the Cascadia subduction zone in the Seattle area and the potential for something on the range of 8.7 to 9.2 and the potential casualties associated with that, tsunamis, displaced people, and the odds of that earthquake occurring in the next 15 years, which is pretty staggering when you think about 1 in 3 chance of such an event occurring in the next 50 years. But the really, really big one that many of us are concerned about, particularly those of us on the East Coast, is the New Madrid seismic zone. So the largest earthquake ever to occur in the U.S., what we believe, we didn't have instrumentation, didn't occur in California, in the continental U.S. outside of Alaska. It occurred in New Madrid region in 1811, 1812, a series of earthquakes that were felt as far west as Denver and as far east as Philadelphia. So a really large area that was impacted, a really large earthquake. And I was part of the Mid-America Earthquake Center, which was one of the earth engineering centers that was funded by the National Science Foundation. We spent years really trying to understand what would happen when the New Madrid earthquake occurs again in terms of the infrastructure failures and the impact of that. And this is some of the statistics that was predicted by the May Center in terms of the number of states affected, the number of potential casualties, as well as the economic losses on the order of $500 billion from a New Madrid type event. If you think about all the infrastructure that crosses the Mississippi River, all the states that are affected, fairly populated cities, St. Louis and Memphis are very close to that. This earthquake is one that really scares many of us when it happens again, because we're not quite ready for this in the central U.S., certainly not as ready as you are in California. California certainly has done a lot to prepare itself for the eventuality of a large earthquake, whether in Southern California or in Northern California. So this earthquake certainly concerns many of us. So as I mentioned before, to study these events and to really deal with these events, you really need to have a multi-scale approach. So I'm going to just highlight a couple of projects that we've worked on that really try to work to the best of our ability across the various scales, starting from really the nanoscale all the way up to looking at systems and cities and states and trying to understand hazards and reduce the risk. So one of the projects that I've worked on for the past 10 to 12 years is looking at new materials. And in this case, we're looking at what we call shape memory alloy material, which is a metallic alloy which really has some very unique properties. It's been primarily used in the biomedical fields. Those of you who have glasses that sort of bend, they're probably made of shape memory alloys, nickel titanium material, golf clubs now, medical stents are made of these materials. They're really a unique set of materials that have the ability to essentially stretch a significant amount and recover their original shape with very little permanent deformation. So very different from what we see in steel or concrete, which are the traditional materials that us as civil engineers are used to dealing with. And so these materials have some really unique characteristics in terms of their stress-strain diagram, which is one of the things that we look at in these materials. They have great recentering capability, very small residual strains. And so you can take it out to on the order of 6 to 8% strain, and it can recover the majority of that, which is, again, very different from what we're used to dealing with in the civil engineering domain. It has hysteretic damping. It forms a stress plateau, and it strain hardens at larger strains. And this property, we believe, can be repeated multiple times. When I first started working with these materials, I was told about the many challenges we needed to overcome to see these materials be effective within natural hazard mitigation domain. So one was very limited understanding between the micro properties and the macro properties. So what does a microstructure look like to have certain macro properties? Very little was really understood about this material. To this day, there are a lot of things we don't understand. Lack of knowledge regarding size effects. The majority of the work that had been done when we started looking at this was done on small wires because most of the applications were in the biomedical field where they needed very, really thin and small wires. Current material models were too complex, and we needed to find effective ways to actually use this in our buildings and bridges and other infrastructure systems. So we looked at a multiple scale over many years, starting at the nano and micro level, working closely with material scientists, all the way up to some full-scale testing that we just recently completed a few years ago. So I'll just highlight a few things here. Again, this is the sort of the microstructure and what makes this material unique. It goes through a transformation and it from one state to another state, and it can repeat that instantaneously and repeatedly, which provides it with what we see as this really, on the surface, very, very unique behavior. And I'll show you just a small video in a minute. The material behavior is a function of temperature, one of the challenges. So if you're not operating in the right temperature range, it's going to have a very different behavior than what you would expect. And so we're looking for the material to operate in its super elastic range. And so we work with material manufacturers to make sure that we're operating in that range. And so some of the first things that we did early on were really trying to understand the microstructure, working with material scientists at Georgia Tech, trying to understand the relationship between the microstructure and what we're seeing in terms of the material behavior. Because prior to that, really none of that had been known very well, particularly for some of the larger sections that we were able and interested in looking at, which we needed to look at to be able to work in our civil engineering domain. And so we did a series of tests of various bars at various sizes, and we wanted to record some of these values, the unloading stress, the forward stress, the residual strain, as well as the damping that we would have in these materials. And I think this is the video. Let me just hit it. It's about a 10-second video, just to give you a sense of really how unique and how flexible these materials. This is a metallic material, and you can sort of bend it. It looks almost viscoelastic in terms of its ability to deform, but yet it's a nickel titanium material that more or less recovers its entire shape upon the unloading sequence. So really, really, really unique material, and our goal in all of our studies was to try to understand the scale effects, the micro to macro behavior relationship, and what's happening when you take it out to higher strain rates. And what I'm showing here on the right-hand side is the comparison of a wire versus a bar. At the time that we tested this bar, it was the first time a bar had been tested at that size. And working closely with manufacturers, we were able to get really, really great super elastic behavior, which hadn't been seen before because of the way we heat treated it and the cold work we put in the material. Again, most of the tests that had been done before had been done on coupon samples, and we were able to show the relationship between the coupon sample behavior as well as that we get in the larger samples. So we spent years really trying to understand that, optimize that, and we felt very good about our ability to get great behavior in bars. But if you only have bars, you're limited in terms of how you can apply them in structure. So we spent a couple of years working with the manufacturers to look at other forms of the material, including other loading forms, because primarily we had used it in axial tension and compression. So we developed other forms of the material, primarily for bending. We developed this coil that undergoes bending and torsion. We developed a cable that's made of a lot of wires. We ended up using that cable, Brian's here, in a cable restrainer test, which Brian earlier said that there may be some challenges with cable restrainers. And we found that this works really well in terms of restraining the relative opening between bridge decks. And so we wanted to look at all these different shapes to see how they perform and whether these materials perform as well in bending and torsion as they do in axial loads. And here we see just, again, some different force displacement relationships with some of the forms of the material. The one that really works the best, I mean, of all the things we tested, was this ring on the left-hand side here. It's just a shape memory alloy ring, and you can pull and push it, and it always comes back to its circular form, and it gets really high levels of force for a fairly small amount of material. And we actually looked at it in a retrofit, putting it in a diagonal in a building where the actual ring is just in the center, and you're pulling on it on either side. Really, really nice behavior. Again, we did a number of different applications. Again, that's showing the restrainer cable application. It worked really well in terms of reducing the displacements in a bridge. And then we did this test of a connection. So the Northridge earthquake highlighted some vulnerabilities that we have in steel columns, beam column connections. And so we want to see whether or not we can sort of develop the next generation of connections between a beam and a column by putting these materials as a connecting element between that. And so we did a series of tests. We did one in full scale. This one is a quarter scale test that we did at our lab. We did it in a quasi-static form. We put on the SAC protocol to this connection. And we ended up with really nice, sort of nice behavior for our connection as shown here. And so play this video real quickly. What you can see from here is that we're cycling it back and forth. We're not getting very much in terms of strength degradation. And what we're most excited about is this thing just comes right back through the center, meaning it truly recentered its behavior after undergoing fairly large rotations in this connection. So really excited about that. We then wanted to see, well, what does that mean if we put this in a building now? Sure, it's great to have the connection work well, but does it really improve the overall behavior of a building? So we tested it analytically in a building, developing an analytical model of it, as shown in the upper right. We put it in a model, open seas model of a three-story building, and we conducted tons of analyses, and essentially the summary is it works really well for larger earthquakes. If you have a moderate-sized earthquake, it doesn't work as well as it does in a large earthquake. If you look at peak displacements, if you look at residual displacements, meaning how much does it come back, it works exceptionally well because of the fact that it truly recenters a building after an earthquake. And some of us believe that perhaps the residual displacement in a building after an earthquake is more important than the peak displacement. And that's something that certainly can be argued by different researchers. But it works very well in terms of recentering a building after an event. One of the projects that we literally just completed was a NICE project, which looked at, can we do this in full scale? So this is a full-scale building. And let me quickly tell you why it's a full-scale building in our lab. So we proposed this project to find an existing building somewhere in the US that we can use, the owner would let us use, and tear to destruction. So we said, let's go to Detroit. Lots of buildings in Detroit that nobody wants. This is kind of in the height of the Depression in Detroit. So we went there. We couldn't find nobody would give us a building that we really wanted in terms of it fit our criteria that they would allow us to tear down to destruction. So after about a year of looking for a building that we couldn't find, we said, well, let's just build our own building and build it as if it was a 1960s era California building prior to the time that California started having really good seismic details. So we did that. We did that in the yard of our structures lab. This is a full-scale building that we constructed. And then we cut it into four pieces so we'd have four different sections of the building that we can actually test independently. And we can test different retrofits and test it without any retrofit to see how bad it is and then see how well the different retrofits work. Each one was instrumented with something on the order of 400 part pieces of instrumentation. Strain gauges, LVDTs, et cetera. So it was a really well-instrumented series of frames that we tested. And what we did is we developed a shape memory alloy brace, as shown in the lower right, full-scale brace, and we put it in the two bays on the bottom, and the shaker, which was a knee shaker, was on top. I think it's the UCLA shaker. was on top, and we tested it by shaking on the top and looking at how the deformations in the building change as a function of the shape memory alloy brace in the building. So we just completed these tests where the students are still pouring through all the data. Visually, it worked very well. If you look at the frame that was not retrofitted, it nearly collapsed. And in fact, we had some safe mechanisms to keep it from collapsing by having these ropes that engaged once it got close to collapsing. And we also had a catcher frame because we didn't want this building collapsing with this expensive system on top of it, and the safety issues, of course, for the students. But I didn't mean to say it like that, but certainly the student safety was paramount in this. But we also didn't want it to break the shaker because it was very expensive. But the building that was not retrofitted really performed not well. One of the other issues that we had was, and some of you can appreciate this, when dealing with facilities on campus to build this, we were building this thing on campus, and it didn't meet code. And people on facilities wouldn't let it build it because it didn't meet code. But we told them we were designing it not to meet code. And we kind of went in this circle for about 3 months before we finally had to engage the provost and others to get this building approved that we were designing not to be safe. So it was really quite a comedy. It delayed the project literally by 3 months because they wouldn't approve us building something that wasn't per code. But anyway, we really showed that these systems can work really well in full scale. And again, we're looking forward to sort of publishing some of these results from this system. Okay, last 5 minutes, I want to talk a little bit about what we're doing here in California, a project. And I see a couple people from Caltrans here, including my sponsor, actually. This is a really exciting project that we have in California, looking at the transportation network. When I talk about the scale, I talked about the nanoscale up to the testing the building scale. And then now, how do we understand what's happening on a community or state or even country level? And so this is a project where we're looking at the transportation system in California and helping to build a system that will allow them to better understand what happens after an earthquake unfolds and where do we send inspectors to look at earthquakes, bridges that might be damaged. So the idea is to develop a more accurate model to incorporate into the Caltrans ShapeCast program to be able to alert inspectors as to where to go right after an event happens. And so this is just a layout of how this project works. You have ShakeMap, which is a USGS. It tells you right after an earthquake what the level of shaking is throughout the state of California. And the idea is to superimpose on that ShakeMap vulnerability models of the bridges that are in the state so that you can say, given the shaking here and the vulnerability of this bridge, it has an X probability of being damaged to a certain level. So that inspectors really know where to go and can quickly respond in the case of an earthquake event. And so what's sort of different about what we're doing is if you think about the state of California, it has 24,000 bridges. And so one approach is to model all 24,000 bridges. We just don't have, I work the students really hard, but I can't work them that hard that they can literally model all 24,000 bridges. The current approach that's used essentially represents the bridges in roughly 5 to 8 classes. It tries to represent the 24,000 bridges. We think we can do much better than that. And so the goal is to sort of come up with a subset of bridges that really represent all 24,000 bridges fairly well. And right now, just looking at one subclass, we're able to develop, using statistical tools, we believe we can model, represent the majority of the bridges with 129 classes. When we're all done, we think we'll have around 300 models that can represent all the bridges in California very well. So when that earthquake hits, we think we'll have a really good sense of where the damage is, and not only where the damage is, and I'll skip the details here, not only where the damage is, but more importantly, where on the bridge you might have damage. So it would sort of tell inspectors, go look at the columns, go look at the bearings, go look at the abutments. So it gives you much better situational awareness as to where you might need to go in an earthquake event. So we're really excited about this project, and I think it'll have a huge impact on the state of California and its ability to respond after an earthquake. So here is sort of a summary in terms of what I think are the opportunities in terms of earthquake risk mitigation. Certainly lots of things are happening with new materials. They can really provide enhanced performance. There are a lot of things going on around the country in terms of better concrete, more ductile concrete, more sustainable concrete, which I think can have an impact in the built environment. Certainly lots of things happening with the ability to model much more. I mean, we're running tons of simulations to be able to develop these models. And as computer speeds get better and better, we can do a lot more in terms of modeling things. And I think the idea of the cell phone and the cell phone acting as a sensor and citizens as sensors, I think it's going to change the way that we develop tools to be able to not only understand earthquakes, but also be able to respond to earthquakes, I think, in real time. So my last 2 minutes, I'm going to talk a little bit about empowering future leaders. There are many students here, and the majority of my time at Georgia Tech is spent being a school chair and thinking about how we can educate our students to be the next generation of leaders, particularly within the civil engineering domain, which I think is a very special profession in terms of what we do around the world. So one of the things that we recently developed was this Global Engineering Leadership Minor that we developed last year, was approved this year. It's a 15-credit undergraduate program that helps students understand what does it take to be a leader within the domain of your profession, and what sort of skills do you need to do this. And so it's a really exciting minor that we've gotten approved. We have roughly 20 students in the minor right now. It's growing fairly fast. Let me talk a little bit about sort of the underlying thinking behind it. If you look at many College of Engineering strategic plans, they talk about leadership and globalization and ethics as tools that we need to instill in our students. Yet we didn't see necessarily anywhere in our curriculum that really hits those things hard. So we said, let's develop a minor that really focuses on some of those activities. And if you can look at the Engineer of 20 or Vision 2020, which also talks about global citizenship, ethical grounding, ability to lead in business and public service, this is what we should be able to do as civil and environmental engineers. And so the minor consists of a series of classes. First, you take a Foundations of Leadership class in public policy, so you got to do a lot of reading in terms of foundations of leadership. And then we have a class that we developed ourselves and we teach ourselves. In fact, Rudy Bonaparte, who some of you may know from GeoSyntec, he's a CEO of GeoSyntec, who headquartered in Atlanta. He teaches a class about leadership and how you become a leader in a large firm and writing a business plan and taking that business plan global. We also have our former president, former head of the Smithsonian, who talks about globalization and leadership, as well as one of our former alumni who is the head of NATO that comes in and talks about some of the challenges happening around the world and why it's important as students to understand what's going on around the world and be able to use that in what you're doing. So really, really exciting, exciting minor, exciting to see our students go out there and do it. The other aspect of this minor is that we have a series of classes that all have a study abroad component. So the students will learn about water technologies in developing countries in class, and during spring break, instead of going to Florida, they will go to, in this case, Bolivia, and install a water system that they learned about in their class in a developing community for 1 week. They leave on Friday and come back literally Sunday night before class starts. It just completely changes their view on things. To have to do something within the context of a different country and language and culture really is an incredible thing, and they leave a culture, leave a community much better off. And we have a series of those classes that all have a study abroad component, including one that went to Amsterdam to study biking. They could have came here to study biking. I just realized that now. They could have come here, but Amsterdam is known as the biking city, so they went there to look at biking so that we can bring that knowledge back to the city of Atlanta, because we are not a biking city. So we actually brought some of the officials from the city of Atlanta to go look at what's happening in Amsterdam to see how we can make our community a much better biking city. So I'm really proud of the things that our students do. I'm proud of all this generation of students in terms of your passion for your profession, your like to go out there and make a difference. And I have a lot of faith. I have a lot of faith in this generation of students that you guys are really special. And again, I appreciate the opportunity to come here and share my thoughts with you, and I'll be happy to take any questions.
Thank you so much for the great introduction.
Yes, sir.
So I'll be happy to take some questions for Professor DesRoches.
Quick comment. Davis people study Amsterdam also.
Is that right?
And the question is regarding the success story in the building in Haiti. What year was it built, and what's the equivalent year of California building standards?
Yeah, that's a great question. It wasn't built to the current code. I want to say the building was built in the late 80s, and it was probably built to a early 80s code, California code, roughly. So it wasn't the up-to-date code, ACI code, but it was good enough. I mean, it was certainly, you know, if you put enough details in these buildings, that's what we always tell students. Even if you don't get the forces exactly right, if you put the right details in a building, you give the building a chance to survive, and you give the people inside the building a chance to survive, more importantly. Yes?
Thank you so much for your presentation. I have a quick question regarding kind of your last point, as citizens as sensors, and that really connects to the citizen science movement, and the kinds of tools that students can also be tested. I know last year, Japan, the hashtag earthquake was the number one hashtag in Japanese. I've been working on a project called Emerji, which would be a hashtag of an emoji of an earthquake. Do you think that would be something useful to be able to search, maybe historically, but currently? How are you seeing citizens document earthquakes?
Yeah, and I think certainly Japan. I think some of it's taking place in California. I know some of my colleagues are trying to develop applications where people, you know, an easy thing would be an application after you felt an earthquake, right? Did you feel it? I think that's a California thing. Did you feel it, right? So did you feel it, for example? Did you feel an earthquake? And sort of indicating what's happening in real time as the earthquake unfolds in terms of the situational awareness as people are trying to respond to the earthquake. So that's sort of what I mean by citizens as sensors. Us individually using this tool in our pocket to be able to sort of monitor how things are unfolding and then using that data, right, and to be able to do things better the next time. So that's sort of the idea, this whole idea of there's tons of data out there as people are moving around after an event. Can we use that data to be able to better plan for the next event?
In terms of the class and the initiative at the end there, I was curious in terms of the class and the initiative at the end there, thinking in terms of similar outreach to practicing engineers, those who graduated 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 years before you started that program, and your thoughts on that and the role of the university in that.
Yeah. So, in fact, with that's a great question. So, the question, if you didn't hear, was what? How about bringing in practicing engineers that have been out for a few years? And in fact, for this one, we did. We brought many practicing engineers from the city of Atlanta, partly because we wanted to convince them, partly because they had expertise that, from a practicing perspective, that the students didn't have or the faculty didn't have, but also to kind of pull them in and say, this is what we can do in Atlanta. I think with some of the other classes, we've seen many requests from some of our alumni to participate with some of these classes or EWB students that go out. And so I think bringing in alumni and practicing engineers has a major benefit because they've been there, they've done it. They can impart some wisdom that, frankly, I don't have or some of my colleagues don't have because they don't have the experience. So I think that's a great suggestion. I think that's something we're trying to infuse within this course.
Out to them in terms of if they didn't have that kind of global thinking, so to speak, multifaceted, that they get that later on in their career.
Oh, you mean afterwards? Yeah, no, I think that would be great. But we find that a lot of alumni do have that, but they have it, but they wish, boy, I wish I had learned some things in school to be able to better prepare me for the eventuality of working in these different cultures. That's sort of the motivation for us having done it to begin with. It's because they say, well, I wish I had learned this in school to be able to prepare us for this. And so that's what we're finding. Yes?
Thank you for coming. As a freshman, do you recommend studying, I'm trying to get a civil engineer major. Do you recommend studying abroad to study other infrastructures in other countries?
Absolutely. Study abroad, if you can. If you can do it. You know, I recommend to my the students, you got to do a number of things before you graduate. If you can, do a research experience because it gives you a very different way of thinking. Study abroad, right? Study abroad, whether you're doing a semester abroad or a year abroad or some short term. Certainly study abroad and get involved in service. You'll be surprised. Not only is it important, not only does the person on the other end get a lot of it, but you will get a lot out of it. And it's important to do, and it really puts things in perspective in terms of your role as an engineer. So yes, if you can study abroad, I would absolutely encourage you to do it. I always tell our students, there's no reason to rush out of here in 4 years just to get out of here. Spend an extra half a year. I know there are financial issues around that. I understand that. But
Your experience at school is such a special time for you in terms of what you're doing and what you're learning. It's worth it. So if you can do it, absolutely, I would say to do it. Yes?
I was wondering, so somewhat related to the Global Leaders program at, or I can't remember the name, but the program at Virginia Tech. And it, you talked about how ASCE sometimes gives a grading of a D or a C minus to U.S. infrastructure, but of course, as you experienced in Haiti and as you talked about, there are other places in the world which are much more vulnerable to natural disasters than probably we are in most cases in the U.S. So I was just wondering, what do you think the role is of people from America or other developed countries in helping improve infrastructure and resiliency in these less developed countries, like, you know, taking leadership roles to actually lead the development of better infrastructure, or is that more up to, or is it more in contributing to education there so that they can be able to handle those issues themselves?
I think it has to do more with building capacity. So you're not going to go to, I don't see you necessarily going to another country and building infrastructure for them. I think you want to build capacity is what you want to do. And I think, and I always say this, much of the problem in Haiti is because people went there and didn't really build up the capacity in the country. They gave things to the people. And I think that's the wrong approach. You want to go there and you want to build capacity working side by side with the people in Haiti. Clearly, they will learn a lot from the knowledge that we have, but you'll be surprised as how much you can learn from these countries that have a very different sort of social context that they're working in. We can learn a lot from that also. So yes, I think you want to go in there and not build infrastructure, but sort of help build capacity in these countries so that they can build for their own.
I have a question. So yes. You had mentioned, you had complimented California on its preparedness. What do you see as the major weakness for California?
The major weakness, I say preparedness because I've worked with many of the, there's awareness here, for one. I think a big part of it is that people here are aware. You know what to do, I think, when you have an earthquake here. I guarantee you they do not know what to do in Georgia or in Tennessee or even in South Carolina where they have earthquakes. So I think they're very prepared here. I think the various agencies, and I'm not complimenting Caltrans because they're here, but, you know, and I told this to Brian earlier, Caltrans is the most prepared, most technically competent DOT when it comes to earthquake design because, you know, you've had earthquakes here. And so I think from a technical perspective, you're in great shape. I think the reality is you're just very vulnerable because you have a lot of earthquakes in Southern California, Northern California, and you have a lot of people and you have a lot of assets at risk if you think about where these earthquakes are, right? I think California is the eighth largest economy in the country. So, you know, I think that's the biggest weakness, if you would call it a weakness. It's just a major vulnerability because of where you are. But I think they're doing a lot to be prepared for when that eventuality happens.
We have time for one more question. Anyone have a burning question?
Just to follow up on that question, right, there are still a lot of vulnerable buildings, you know, older buildings.
Sure.
As well. I mean, you know, are some of the work that you've done with your SMEs and so on, look again, those kind of non-ductile and older construction that still is around in California?
Yeah. So I know there was a study that looked at, I guess, identified 1,000 or so dangerous buildings in LA, right? This is one that I think Jack Mealy did, which sort of scared some people because they literally identified the buildings that were vulnerable, which clearly people want to know, is my building vulnerable? So I think part of it is a policy issue. I mean, how do you get people to retrofit a building once you know it's vulnerable? I think that's sort of the issue. It's an issue here and certainly an issue on the East Coast because people completely, there's lots of vulnerable buildings, but how do you determine whether or not it's worth the investment to put into it's much harder on the East Coast to do that because here, you know, the risk is just staring at you. I think it's sort of a policy thing and it's a time thing and it's a money thing. But I think some of these technologies can certainly help. I think as with anything with our profession, it takes a little bit longer than we would like. Things don't happen overnight in terms of getting things in codes and getting things approved. So it's going to take time. And hopefully you have time here.
All okay, right. One more.
Professor DesRoches,
yes.
I want to compliment you for bringing up the issue of vulnerability, fragility, and I'm going to use the word that you didn't use, probabilistic approaches. It is not accepted yet because people are not comfortable with it. You didn't use the word, but it was in your presentation. And I really hope you keep pushing it, because that's the right way to go. It's the only way to go. And good for you. Keep it up.
Thank you. Thank you, Ron. I appreciate that.
Before
that's a good little plug. I didn't even pay him to do that, by the way. So.
Before we thank our speaker, I have two things I want to mention. First of all, right after, we have a lovely reception for you all out on the courtyard here. And second of all, I want to present a gift to you from our college. We do a national mailing of our college distinguished lecturers. So this was mailed to heads and chairs of civil engineering and deans across the country. And we wanted to frame that for you for your office.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. My kids will not believe they framed my picture. They'll get a kick out of this, that's for sure. Thank you very much again for your time.